American life in 1927 was progressing and modernizing at a faster rate than ever. The first transatlantic call was made, covering nearly 7,300 miles from San Francisco to London. Charles Lindbergh made his historic solo flight from New York to Paris, spawning a ticker tape parade that cost the city of New York $16,000 to clean up. President Coolidge urged Americans to pray more. The New York Yankees boasted their murderer's row batting lineup at its peak in 1927, with Babe Ruth setting a standard for home run hitting, 60, that would hold up for almost 35 years. Lou Gehrig hit 378 with 47 homers of his own. Hostess Cakes and Lender's Bagels made their debut in this year. So-called hot jazz was at its creative and commercial peak, with musicians such as Jelly Roll Morton, Louis Armstrong with his wife Lil Hardin Armstrong, Frank Trumbauer, and Bix Beiderbecke creating music that would influence for generations to come. But far away from the bright lights, the flappers, and the speakeasies, in the hollers of Hunter, Kentucky, a baby girl was born on August 29th. Her parents were Robert and Rebecca, and her name was Helene, which she changed to Helen in 1949. She grew up in a coal mining area of Floyd County, Kentucky, where her father worked the coal mines while her mother took care of the four children, and many times three or four others, too. She was the third of four children, Mathis, Ernest, Helene, and then Etta Mae. Mathis and Ernest both joined the service. Becky, their mother, Helen, and Etta Mae moved north to Rittman, Ohio in March of 1943, while Bob, their father, stayed in Kentucky to continue his job in the coal mines. The family moved into a government housing project home called Willowbrook, and Helen, at the age of 16, got a job in the gluing department of the Ohio Boxboard Company, now the Packaging Corporation of America. Many residents of Rittman worked at the box board, but there was one in particular who would change her life forever.
In 1929, many changes were taking place in society. Some of these changes were for the good of the country, and some would prove to be so devastating that many would never be able to recover from them. For the first time that year, we saw 7-Up, Popeye, Oscar Mayer Wieners, mobile homes, and paper money the size it is today. Babe Ruth hit his 500th home run, while Lefty O'Doul got a record 254 hits. The hit songs were Tiptoe Through the Tulips and Singin' in the Rain. The stock market saw an all-time high of 381 and then plummeted to an all-time low. Billions were lost overnight, and unemployment rose from 700,000 to 3 million. On April 11, 1929, Germany denied political asylum to Leon Trotsky, and on that same day in the mountains of West Virginia, in a place that is called Almost Heaven, a baby boy was born. In Pritchard, West Virginia, up in a holler called Little Hurricane, William Kenneth was born to Clyde and Alice McComas. Clyde was a railroader, and Alice took care of the seven children. The family knew well what poverty was, but they were rich in love. Money seemed to be rare for everyone in the country during the Great Depression, but none more so than for the McComas family. When Kenny turned 14 in September of 1943, he arrived in the little town of Rittman for good. His means of transportation was a train that traveled the long black ribbon of track to a life that he was unsure of and a place that he had never been. His origination was Hubbardstown, West Virginia, riding on the N&W number 19, and he arrived at the depot in Rittman on the C&O line. He found a job working at the Ohio Boxboard Company in the scrapping department. After working in the scrapping department for a while, he was moved to the gluing department, where he worked as a finisher. There were three women who worked with him in that area, and he thought that one of them was just the cat's pajamas. Kenny thought that one girl in particular was just beautiful. Too beautiful, in fact, for him to even have the courage to talk to her, let alone ask her out on a date. That was July of 1945, and although he didn't know it yet, within one short year he would be married to that girl in the gluing department, that beautiful girl from Hunter Holler, Kentucky, that girl named Helen Salisbury. Kenny finally summoned the courage to ask Helen if he could walk her home one day, and to his amazement, she said yes. They decided to stop at the local diner, Punch and Judy's, for burgers and Cokes. On their second date, they went back to Punch and Judy's. There was an area cleared off for dancing, and when a coin was dropped into the jukebox, the place was up and moving. Kenny soon found out that Helen did the jitterbug better than anyone else. Kenny bought Helen a doll from Chippewa Lake Amusement Park, and it was becoming more and more clear that he was around to stay. After Kenny purchased his first car, a 1932 Chevrolet Coupe with just one seat in it, he would take Helen to West Virginia and Kentucky to meet each other's families. 1946 gave us the classic movie It's a Wonderful Life, starring Donna Reed and Jimmy Stewart. 1946 also took us on a little trip to Catlettsburg, Kentucky to see Henry Hendricks, a justice of the peace. On July 27, 1946, Helen Salisbury became Mrs. Helen McComas as they set out on their own wonderful life. There was no beautiful music, no fragrant flowers to hold, no fancy reception, but there was love. Enough love to see them through the ups and downs of life, the bills, the children, the sickness, and even 45 years of the ministry. The first few weeks of marital bliss were spent with Helen's mother, Becky. During this time, work was being completed on the couple's first home, a chicken slaughterhouse located on Route 57A just outside of Rittman. This adorable property was being converted into a three-room apartment that would be home to the newlyweds for just over a year. In the winter of 1947, it was time to move up in the world. They left the chicken house and moved into a converted garage.
When you walk down the road, heavy burden, heavy load, I will rise and I will walk with you.
I will walk with you.
When you walk
you
through
walk.
The night and you feel like you want to just give up, give up, give up on the fight.
Yeah,
I will
up.
Come and I will walk with you.
Oh, walk with you.
Until
yeah.
The sun don't even shine.
Walk with you.
I'll be there all the time. I tell you, I'll walk. When you walk
from this place,
and you gotta go to meet him, it's time to meet him face to face.
Take my hand,
and I will walk with you.
Just look into the
never here to awake again. But everything was all right between her and him. So she awoke in heaven's courtyard, free from pain within. The angels gathered around her, and they took her by the hand, serenaded by angels, up to the throne. Serenaded by angels, finally at home, surrounded by praises to the King.
Darkness in this world we stumble through, all these questions I can't answer, so much work to do. But when I get where I'm going and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace.
In June of 1997, Karen went to heaven after a brave battle with a rare form of cancer. She had been a church musician for more than 35 years, and she suffered through her illness with grace and dignity. She was a true lady, a godly woman. Karen was loved by everyone who knew her, and she is missed terribly by Kenny, Helen, and the rest of the family. But knowing that they will see her again in heaven gives them all reason to go on.
Somehow, though the devil tempt me and he tries to turn me around. wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. Well, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. I gotta make it to heaven somehow. Oh, the devil take me and he tries to turn me around.
Every rhyme and every tune, but remember the truth of Jesus' love.